Macmillan Audio presents Lamentation by Ken Scholes. Read for you by Scott Brick, William Dufris, Maggi-Meg Reed, and Stefan Rudnicki.
Prelude. Windwir is a city of paper and robes and stone. It crouches near a wide and slow-moving river at the edge of the named lands, named for a poet turned pope, the first pope in the New World, a village in the forest that became the center of the world, home of the Andro-Francine Order and their great library, home of many wonders both scientific and magical. One such wonder watches from high above. It is a bird made of metal, a gold spark against the blue expanse that catches the afternoon sun. The bird circles and waits. When the song begins below, the golden bird watches the melody unfold. A shadow falls across the city and the air becomes still. Tiny figures stop moving and look up. A flock of birds lift and scatter. The sky is torn and fire rains down until only utter darkness remains. Darkness and heat. The heat catches the bird and tosses it farther into the sky. A gear slips. The bird's wings compensate, but a billowing black cloud takes an eye as it passes. The city screams and then sighs 7 times, and after the 7th sigh, sunlight returns briefly to the scorched land. The plain is blackened, the spires and walls and towers all brought down into craters where basements collapsed beneath the footprint of desolation. A forest of bones, left whole by ancient blood magic, stands on the smoking, pockmarked plain. Darkness swallows the light again as a pillar of smoke and ash blots out the sun. Finally, the golden bird flees southwest. It easily overtakes the other birds, their wings smoking and beating furiously against the hot winds, messages tied to their feet with threads of white or red or black. Sparking and popping, the golden bird speeds low across the landscape and dreams of its waiting cage.
Chapter 1. Rudolfo. Wind swept the prairie sea, and Rudolfo chased after it, laughing and riding low in the saddle as he raced his gypsy scouts. The afternoon sun glinted gold on the bending grass, and the horses pounded out their song. Rudolfo savored the wide yellow ocean of grass that separated the 9-fold forest houses from one another and from the rest of the named lands. It was his freedom in the midst of duty, much as the oceans must have been for the seagoing lords of the elder days. He smiled and spurred his stallion. It had been a fine time in Glimmerglam, his first forest house. Rudolfo had arrived before dawn. He'd taken his breakfast of goat cheese, whole grain bread, and chilled pear wine beneath a purple canopy that signified justice. While he ate, he heard petitions quietly as Glimmerglam's steward brought the month's criminals forward. Because he felt particularly benevolent, he sent 2 thieves into a year's servitude to the shopkeepers they'd defiled, while sending the single murderer to his physicians of penitent torture on Tormentor's Row. He dismissed 3 cases of prostitution, and then afterward hired 2 of them onto his monthly rotation. By lunchtime, Rudolfo had proven Atero's theory of compensatory seduction decidedly false, and he celebrated with creamed pheasant served over brown rice and wild mushrooms. Then, with his belly full, he'd ridden out with a shout, his gypsy scouts racing to keep up with him. A good day, indeed. "What now?" the captain of his gypsy scouts asked him, shouting above the pounding hooves. Rudolfo grinned. "What say you, Gregorik?" Gregorik returned the smile, and it made his scar all the more ruthless. His black scarf of rank trailed out behind him, ribboning on the wind. "We've seen to Glimmerglam, Rudaheim, and Friendslip. I think Paramo was the closest. Then Paramo it is. That would be fitting, Rudolfo thought. It couldn't come close to Glimmer Glam's delights, but it had held on to its quaint logging village atmosphere for at least 1,000 years, and that was an accomplishment. They floated their timber down the Rouge Blood River, just as they had in the first days, retaining what they needed to build some of the world's most intricately crafted woodwork. The lumber for Rodolfo's manors came from the trees of Paramo. The furniture they made rolled out by the wagon load, and the very best found its way into the homes of kings and priests and nobility from all over the named lands. He would dine on roast boar tonight, listen to the boasting and flatulence of his best men, and sleep on the ground with a saddle beneath his head. The life of a gypsy king. And tomorrow he'd sip chilled wine from the navel of a log camp dancer, listen to the frogs in the river shallows mingled with her sighs, and then sleep in the softest of beds on the summer balcony of his third forest manor. Rudolfo smiled. But as he rounded to the south, his smile faded. He reined in and squinted against the sunlight. The gypsy scouts followed his lead, whistling to their horses as they slowed, stopped, and then pranced. Gods, Gregorik said. What could cause such a thing? Southwest of them, billowing up above the horizon of forest line that marked Rodolfo's farthest border, a distant pillar of black smoke rose like a fist in the sky. Rudolfo stared and his stomach lurched. The size of the smoke cloud daunted him. It was impossible. He blinked as his mind unlocked enough for him to do the math, quickly calculating the distance and direction based on the sun and the few stars strong enough to shine by day. Windwir, he said, not even aware that he was speaking. Gregorik nodded. Aye, General, but what could do such a thing? Rudolfo looked away from the cloud to study his captain. He'd known Gregorik since they were boys, and it made him the youngest captain of the Gypsy Scouts at 15 when Rudolfo himself was just 12. They'd seen a lot together, but Rudolfo had never seen him pale before now. We'll know soon enough, Rudolfo said. Then he whistled his men in closer. I want riders back to each of the houses to gather the wandering army. We have kinclave with Windwir. Their birds will be flying. We'll meet on the western steps in 1 day. We'll be to Windweir's aid in 3. Are we to magic the scouts, General? Rudolfo stroked his beard. I think not. He thought for a moment. But we should be ready, he added. Gregorik nodded and barked out the orders. As the 9 gypsy scouts rode off, Rudolfo slipped from the saddle, watching the dark pillar. The column of smoke, as wide as a city, disappeared into the sky. Rudolfo, lord of the 9-fold forest houses, general of the wandering army, felt curiosity and fear dance a shiver along his spine. What if it's not there when we arrive? He asked himself. And he knew, but did not want to, that it wouldn't be, and that because of this, the world had changed.
Patronus. Patronus mended the last of the net and tucked it away in the prow of his boat. Another quiet day on the water. Another day of little to show for it, but he was happy with that. Tonight he'd dine at the inn with the others, eating and drinking too much and finally breaking down into the raunchy limericks that made him famous up and down the coast of Caldus Bay. Patronus didn't mind being famous for that at all. Outside of his small village, most had no idea that more fame than that lay just beneath the surface. Patronus the fisherman had lived another life before returning to his nets and his boat. Prior to the day he chose to end that life, Patronus had lived a lie that at times felt more true than a child's love. Nonetheless, it was a lie that ate away at him until he stood up to it and laid it out 33 years ago. Next week, he realized with a smile. He could go months without thinking about it now. When he was younger, it wasn't so. But each year, about a month before the anniversary of his rather sudden and creative departure, memories of Windwir, of its great library, of its robed order, flooded him, and he found himself tangled up in his past like a gull in a net. The sun danced on the water, and he watched the silver waves flash against the hulls of ships, both small and large. Overhead, a clear blue sky stretched as far as he could see, and seabirds darted, shrieking their hunger as they dove for the small fish that dared swim near the surface. One particular bird, a kingfisher, caught his eye, and he followed it as it dipped and weaved. He turned with it, watching as it flexed its wings and glided, pushed back by a high wind that Petronas couldn't see or feel. "I've been pushed by such a wind," he thought. And with that thought, the bird suddenly shuddered in the air as the wind overcame it and pushed it farther back. Then Petronas saw the cloud piling up on the horizon to the northwest. He needed no mathematics to calculate the distance. He needed no time at all to know exactly what it was and what it meant. Windwir. Stunned, he slid to his knees, his eyes never leaving the tower of smoke that rose westward and north of Caldus Bay. It was close enough that he could see the flecks of fire in it as it roiled and twisted its way into the sky. "Oh, my children," Petronas whispered, quoting the first gospel of Pandro Wime, "what have you done to earn the wrath of heaven?"
Jinli Tam. Jinli Tam bit back her laughter and let the fat overseer try to reason with her. "It's not seemly," Sethbert said, "for the consort of a king to ride side saddle." She did not bother to remind him of the subtle differences between an overseer and a king. Instead, she stayed with her point. "I do not intend to ride side saddle either, my lord." Jinli Tam had spent most of the day cramped into the back of a carriage with the overseer's entourage, and she'd had enough of it. There was an army of horses to be had, saddles too, and she meant to feel the wind on her face. Besides, she could see little from the inside of a carriage, and she knew her father would want a full report. A captain interrupted, pulling Sethbert aside and whispering urgently. Jinli Tam took it as her cue to slip away in search of just the right horse, and to get a better idea of what was afoot. She'd seen the signs for over a week. Messenger birds coming and going, cloaked couriers galloping to and fro at all hours of the night, long meetings between old men in uniforms, hushed voices, and then loud voices, and hushed voices again. And the army had come together quickly, brigades from each of the city-states united under a common flag. Now they stretched ahead and behind on the Weimar Highway, overflowing the narrow road to trample the fields and forests in their forced march north. Try as she might, she had no idea why. But she knew the scouts were magicked, and according to the rites of Kinclave, that meant Sethbert and the Andralusian city-states were marching to war. And she also knew that very little lay north, apart from Windwir, the great seat of the Andro-Francine Order, and farther north and east, Rudolfo's ninefold forest houses. But both of those neighbors were kinclave with the Andralusians, and she'd not heard of any trouble they might be in that merited Andralusian intervention. Of course, Sethbert had not been altogether rational of late. Though she cringed at the thought of it, she'd shared his bed enough to know that he was talking in his sleep, and restless, unable to rise to the challenge of his young red-headed consort. He was also smoking more of the dried calaberries, intermittently raging and rambling with his officers. Yet they followed him, so there had to be something. He didn't possess the charm or charisma to move an army on his own, and he was too lazy to move them by ruthlessness, while lacking in the more favorable motivational skills. "What are you up to?" she wondered out loud. "Milady?" A young cavalry lieutenant towered over her on a white mare. He had another horse in tow behind him. She smiled, careful to turn in such a way that he could see down her top just far enough to be rewarded, but not so far as to be improper. "Yes, lieutenant." Overseer Seth Burt sends his compliments and requests that you join him forward. The young man pulled the horse around, offering her the reins. She accepted and nodded. I trust you will ride with me. He nodded. He asked me to do so. Climbing into the saddle, she adjusted her riding skirts and stretched up in the stirrups. Twisting, she could make out the end of the long line of soldiers behind and before her. She nudged the horse forward. Then let's not keep.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.